morning and welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As some of us know, Pastor is in Anchorage for, call it a class, or continuing education or whatever it is. She can speak better to that when she gets back. Do we have any announcements?
Council meeting.
Tuesday. Council meeting on Tuesday, 6:30. Be here or be Zoom. Corny, I know.
We do not need help setting up the food pantry today because we didn't get a chance to take it down last week. So, it's already set up.
So the food pantry is ready, almost ready to go. There's still the things that have to come up. A shout out and a thank you to McGivney's, who donated like 7 cases of bread stuff, be it dinner rolls and hoagie buns and large loaves of bread. He said, I don't want to see it go to waste. It's still good. So can the food bank use it? And I said, sure. We went one step further and used his vehicle to bring it all over so we could put it in the fridge and the freezer. So thanks again to Dave.
Thanks for everyone who did the hot dog thing. We gave away, I think, probably a record number of hot dogs and certainly beverages to keep people from getting dehydrated and all that. So that was great.
Indeed. Thank you. Okay. So service begins. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When we met those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen. Let us sing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the well-being of the Church of God and for the unity of
Let us pray. O Lord God, your mercy delights in us, and the world longs for your loving care. Hear the cries of everyone in need, and turn our hearts to love our neighbors with the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 30. Moses calls the people who are about to enter the promised land to renew the covenant God made with their ancestors. Through this covenant, God gives life and asks for obedience. God's commandment is neither burdensome nor too far off, but dwells in the people's hearts. A reading from Deuteronomy. The Lord your God will make you abundantly prosperous in all your undertakings, in the fruit of your body, in the fruit of your livestock, and in the fruit of your soil. For the Lord will again take delight in prospering you, just as he delighted in prospering your ancestors. When you obey the Lord your God by observing his commandments and decrees that are written in this book of the law, because you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today we have Psalm 25. We will read the uneven verses, and the congregation will read those verses in bold print. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you, that I may not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. If you lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies.
The second reading is taken from Colossians chapter 1. The letter to the Colossians was written to warn its readers of various false teachings. The first part of the letter is an expression of thanks for the faith, hope, and love that mark this community, including a prayer for strength and courage. A reading from Colossians. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learn from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a fellow faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, the word of the Lord.
Please rise as we prepare for the gospel. Jesus is challenged to explain what is involved in obeying the greatest commandment. He tells a parable rich in surprises. Those expected to show pity display hard hearts, while the lowly give and receive unexpected lavish mercy. The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite. And when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him, bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed mercy with him." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. So I had to do a little bit of, I had to tweak our message just a little bit because I see people in the house who may not understand who the Hatfields and McCoys are. Any idea? Got it. Don't worry. So the message on its own this morning, we understand the basics, but there's a lot more going on at the time that we don't know if we don't know the backstory. Samaritans were in conflict with the Israelites. They had a lot of conflicts. So I was going to use the analogy of the Hatfields and McCoys, which are two infamous Western families, or at least Midwestern families, who were at conflict all the time. They were warring all the time. So in that sense, if you see a man in the ditch who has been beat and left half dead, as it says, we would expect a priest to stop, have pity, take care of, shepherd, help nurse back to life, do whatever he could to help. But he didn't. He said he passed on the other side of the road. In other words, I don't see you, I'm going on my way. Now, the Levite who would have had the Torah, he would have had the Jewish laws. And in the Jewish law, as we read, or as Dolores read, in the earlier Deuteronomy, it says in there, love your Lord your God, and on, which was the history that Jesus was asking the lawyer. And the lawyer responded, you shall love your Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and your neighbor, da, da, da. So the Levite, especially in those times, would have been expected to stop and take pity on his fellow man. He too passed on the other side. So it would be like a Hatfield being in the ditch and another Hatfield walking by and turning his head, going to the other side of the road and say, I didn't see you, and walking by. And then the McCoy coming up and seeing somebody in that ditch who is hurting and taking care of them. It's almost that stark, which kind of it brings the story more than just the little sticker on the back of the RV camper that says Good Sam, which is where, of course, the Good Samaritan comes from. It's probably one of the most recognized stories from the Bible. Other things that don't stand out at first reading in here is, so first of all, the lawyer is testing Jesus. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus, there's a name for this that escapes me right now, but he answered his question with a question. And the attorney answered, you shall love your Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said, you've given the right answer. So it's no wonder, by the way, that the answer that he gave came out of our first reading, Deuteronomy. So Jesus was testing him as to his knowledge of how he should act. And he got it right. But wanting to justify himself, he also asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? So Jesus tells a parable. He tells a story, and he tells a story to exemplify who his neighbor is. But he doesn't just come right out and say, well, you know, the people that live within half a mile of you are your neighbor. He didn't do that. In essence, what he said, everybody on the earth is your neighbor. That is your call. Your call is to be a neighbor to everybody that's there. But he does it in the story, and he uses the contrast of the priest, the Levite, and the Samaritan. I was going to use the analogy of the Crips and Bloods, but I didn't think maybe they would get that either. The best analogy would be a huge rivalry between teams that are always butting heads or getting excited during a sporting event, which seems kind of silly, doesn't it? But we do that. So knowing Jesus knew he was being tested, and he's usually always a step ahead of whoever is asking him questions, which is kind of makes reading the Bible fun sometimes, right? And I've said it before and up here that sometimes you can just see Jesus going, you know, doing the dope slap to the back of the head. Come on! So in this instance, he tells the parable to the lawyer, And give me one moment. And then Jesus asked him, after telling the story, the parable, he said, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? And he said, the one who showed him mercy. That's curious, because he didn't refer to the Samaritan by people. He didn't give them credit for being the one that stopped to help as a group of people. He only referred to him as the one who showed mercy. So he admitted that the Samaritan was doing the right thing, but he didn't identify him. He didn't identify him as a race or as a group or as another entity. So that's one of those fun things about this story. So we hear frequently and often to take care of our neighbor, to go and do likewise. In fact, we hear it here just about every week. In our dismissal, for example, it says, go in peace, love your neighbor. How many hundreds of times have we heard that or a variation of that? And maybe the more important question is, how many more times do we need to hear it before we go out and do it? But that's what we're called to do. We're not called to take care of just our next door neighbor. We're not called to just take care of our friends whom we consider neighbors. I've said before, because I heard it when a fellow, I thanked him for an act of kindness, and he said, we take care of friends and family. And I'm thinking I need to amend that. So we need to take care of our friends and our family and our neighbors. It doesn't mince words. It doesn't just say friends and family. It says our neighbors. And who is our neighbor? Our neighbor might even be the faction of people with whom we've had incidents, to put it kindly. And how much of a mind bend would it be to be the person that walks past someone in need and see enemy of us or of the person in the ditch that stops to give comfort and care and pays for them to get better? That would hurt, wouldn't it? So, speaking for myself and with you, let's not be the people that find ourselves in that situation. We're called to go out and love thy neighbor as thyself. And we wouldn't leave ourselves in a ditch. We wouldn't leave ourselves unattended to, half dead. So that's the message I see in today's gospel. Amen.
Thank you.
us confess together. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Bless you.
Come now and fill our spirits, pour out your gifts of love, O living breath of God, Holy Spirit, breathe in us as we pray.
United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. Good and gracious God, you have placed your word of love in the heart of our church. Fill your church with compassion, that we bear the fruit of your healing mercy to a broken world. God of grace, hear our prayer. You created the earth with seeds sprouting up to new life. We pray for the flourishing of fruit trees and orchards, vines and bushes. Prosper the work of those who plant, tend, harvest, and gather. God of grace, show us your ways and teach us your paths of justice and love. Raise up community and national leaders to challenge and dismantle societal structures that perpetuate ethical, racial, and religious profiling and discrimination. God of grace, hear our prayer. Come near to all in need. Orchestrate kindness in the face of cruelty, hope where there is despair, love in the face of neglect, comfort where there is death, and healing in illness. God of grace, hear our prayer. Turn this community towards neighbors in need. Bring aid and support to those who are poor, beaten down, abused, forgotten, silenced, or avoided. God of grace, hear our prayer. You hear the cries of those who seek wisdom. Guide all bishops, pastors, missionaries, and other ministers of the gospel, especially Presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton, Alaska Synod Bishop Shelley Wickstrom, Bishop Tessa Moon Lyseth of our sister synod, and Pastor Karen Perkins. Bless our neighbors in the Southeast Alaska Cluster and in River of Life Lutheran Church, Chugiak. God, in your mercy, and for what else do the people of God pray? For those with addictions. For all our neighbors. We give thanks for the saints who revealed your love and mercy in this life. Inspired by their witness, strengthen us to live in hope. God of grace, hear our prayer. And God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. Amen. Of our Lord be with you always. And let us extend to each other some sign of peace. And since COVID, that means like the peace sign or the heart sign or an acknowledgement, a nod. Family members would be encouraged to hug. Oh, heck, even kiss. For those online, take a moment, make a phone call. Let your neighbors know how you're doing and ask how they're doing. Lucy? Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and give We praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, our Maker, Redeemer, and Healer, in the harmonious world of your creation, the plants and animals, the seas and stars were whole and well in your praise. When sin had scarred the world, you sent your Son to heal our ills and to form us again into one. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks, gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his acts of healing, his body given up, and his victory over death, we await that day when all the peoples of the earth will come to the river to enjoy the tree of life. Send your Spirit upon us, and this meal, as grains scattered on the hillside, become one bread. So let your church be gathered from the ends of the earth, that all may be fed with the bread of life, your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are invited to Christ's table. All are our neighbors. You're welcome to come up and receive the bread and wine. There's wine in the dark liquids in the cups is wine. The light colored liquid is juice. for those who prefer. We also have a gluten-free bread for those who need or want. In Christ's presence, there is a fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. My hands are apparently bigger than pastors. The body of Christ given for you. the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and keep you in God's grace. Life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us announce together, the mission of Resurrection Lutheran Church is to promote spiritual growth in Christ and service to all people. Now receive the blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Go in peace. Love your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Yes.